Right, I welcome you to this discussion focusing on reciprocal models. What I want us to do here is to illustrate this concept of reciprocal models, which is very important. Now, we will discuss this in the context of the Phillips curve model, which you did in 202 with Professor Keaton. But before I do that, I'll explain what we mean when we say variables have a reciprocal relationship. Essentially, it means that they are inversely related. The relationship between them is negative. But the way we construct the test or the relationship is slightly different from the usual way. We will make the variable, the explanatory variable, a non-linear variable. So it's a variable that has an asymptote. And so while the explanatory variable is non-linear, the model itself is linear in parameters, which qualifies it for a linear regression model. So if you have two variables, y and x, okay? If these two variables have a reciprocal relationship, if I regress this on that, I should get a negative sign for the coefficient of this. That essentially tells me that the variables have a reciprocal relationship. But now, to more formally represent this idea of a reciprocal relationship, I have to model y on 1 over x. Now, this particular presentation has several advantages because it helps us identify the limiting value, or what is called the asymptote, the maximum or the minimum most value of y, or that y will assume when this x becomes very, very big. Okay, so as you see, 1 over x here will approach 0 as x becomes large because you are dividing 1 by a very big number. Just imagine if I divide 1 by 1, I get 1. If I make this number here 5, I get 0.2. If I get this number here 10, it becomes 0.1. If I make this number here 20, it becomes 0.05, I think. If I make it 100, it becomes 0.01. If I make it 1000, it becomes 0.001. So what you see is that as x becomes very large, this fraction here approaches zero. It becomes 0.000 something, right? So essentially, it becomes zero. So that means the intercept in the regression of this on that is the limiting value, okay? So now if your y is equal to b1 plus b2 1 over x like this, okay? What you are saying is that as 1 over x approaches 0 because x is becoming very big, beta 2 times 1 over x, the whole thing here becomes 0 and we are left with beta 1. So you are saying as x becomes very large, y approaches the value b1. Okay, so b1 is called the limiting value or the asymptotic value of y. Now, these are the points I've labeled b1 here. Okay, so there are three scenarios. Your relationship might approach the asymptotic the asymptotic value from above. Like here, the curve is declining, but the asymptote itself is in the positive region because it is above zero. Okay? Then you can have a scenario where the asymptote is in the negative region, like this one, it's below zero. So the curve keeps falling, it crosses the zero line. There we go, it approaches its asymptotic value to the far right, but having crossed the zero line here. Or you can have a situation where the asymptote is in the positive, but your curve approaches the asymptote from below. Here it approaches from above. Here it approaches from below. Here it approaches from above, and the asymptote is in the negative. So there are three scenarios here that you observe. So the idea we are giving is that as your x increases, this part here after the plus sign becomes zero, and the intercept here becomes the limiting value or the limit. You are saying when x becomes very, very large, then we observe y to approach a value b1. That's essentially what we are talking about. So now, let me take the Phillips curve relationship and bring it into the picture here for our analysis. So now, from what you did with Prof. Keaton, I will take off this curve so that you can see what I'm talking about. Let me take this one off as well. So the curve we are actually talking about here is this one, but this one is nicely drawn. Maybe I can try my tricks here. I have to ungroup this because I'd grouped them, and then I can move this zero line somewhere above. I can move the zero line above to there. Then this line here, I can move it maybe, let's say, even to here. Yeah, so this is your B1, right? So let's work with this graph. So now I will take that and bring it here. Oh. I didn't realize that something is happening there. NU, that is called the natural rate of unemployment. So now what's happening here is that our explanatory variable here is unemployment, which we are calling U, because we are studying this thing over time, so it's called UT. And the dependent variable is the rate of change of the inflation rate. So in other words, it's the rate at which the inflation rate is changing, because this number here is measured as a percent. So current minus previous value, it is the change in the inflation rate that we are talking about. And this is the unemployment rate. As you can see, these are reciprocally related. So now the natural rate of unemployment, just to recap from what you did with Prof. Keaton, is that rate of unemployment that will keep inflation constant. Why? Because the rate of change of inflation will be zero here. In other words, the inflation rate remains constant from period to period. It is not changing. So if you say current period minus previous period inflation, you get zero because the PT remains the same as PT minus one. They are equal. Okay? Now, so what you see is if we go beyond NU in this direction, we are increasing the levels of unemployment. Now, the reason why we end up having the inflation rate decreasing, it's because as your rate of unemployment increases, from a Keynesian point of view, there is demand deficiency in the economy. An economy might actually fall into a recession because there is weak consumer demand, weak investment demand, and perhaps weak government expenditure. As a result, the equilibrium in the economy is below the full employment equilibrium, or let's say the natural rate of unemployment consistent level of output. The level of output that is consistent with the natural rate of unemployment, we are operating below that. So that means the economy has weak demand. As a result, we might experience a deflation. From your Keynesian cross, the 45 degree line and the aggregate expenditure line, it means you have a deflationary gap. Now, if you have a deflationary gap, then there's a chance that you might actually have the rate at which the inflation rate changes becoming negative. That is, we fall into this region below the zero point, okay? And if we are more concerned about eliminating unemployment, and so we want it to be very low, close to zero, it means the economy might end up overheating. We might end up raising the level of aggregate demand beyond the level of output that is consistent with the natural rate of unemployment. Because of that, we end up experiencing an inflationary gap, and that will cause the rate at which the inflation rate changes to be positive. You see that? So we are now in this region and where the rate of change of the inflation rate is increasing. That's essentially the idea behind the Phillips curve. So we can state it as this: current inflation minus expected inflation is equal to beta 1 by unemployment minus the natural rate. So this idea is the distance. How big is the distance between the unemployment rate we currently have in the economy versus the natural rate of unemployment, which keeps inflation constant? The bigger the gap between these two, then it means that this number here is actually changing. So if U is bigger than that, this number must increase. If U is much smaller than this, then what you should expect is that if U is much bigger than this, that is, we are in that direction, we expect this number to be negative. So I had transposed the idea. So you end up having this one decreasing because you are going far to the right of the natural rate of unemployment. And if U is smaller than the natural rate, it actually means that you have created more employment. The economy is overheating. You end up having this increasing. Okay, good. Remembering that this coefficient actually has a minus sign because there's a reciprocal relationship. So we can then simplify this. If we multiply by B1 into the brackets, we end up having this. But knowing that NU is a constant and B1 is a constant, so this actually becomes our intercept. You see that? So this intercept, we can call it B0, okay? Which means, for example, in this case, this number here could be written as B0, but that's what B0 actually means. It is the asymptotic value. Now, then you can estimate this regression. Now, this one is not stated as an asymptote, as a reciprocal relationship, but we know that these are negatively related, so this coefficient B1 must have a negative sign. But if we want to incorporate the idea of capturing the limiting value, then we must state our unemployment as 1 over unemployment. What this regression says and what that regression says is the same, but the interpretation is different because this one helps us understand the limiting case, whereas this one just tells us by how many percentage points your inflation will change when unemployment changes by a certain number of percentage points or by 1 percentage point as such. So this one is advantageous because it tells us the largest decrease in inflation that we can experience, the largest decrease in the rate of change of the inflation rate if unemployment increases. So this is the advantage of telling us that. This cannot tell us that directly. This one can tell us that, so that this B0 here is the largest decrease in the inflation rate that we can expect to observe as unemployment becomes very, very large. You see that? So that's the idea behind this kind of modeling framework, which is very interesting of its own. So let me stop here. When I come back, we can then estimate the regression.